you want me to. No empty words and no white lies. No token prayers, no compromise. I want to shine the light you gave. Through your Son, you sent to save us from ourselves and our despair. It comforts me to know you're really there. Oh, I want to thank you now for being patient with me. Oh, it's so hard to see when my eyes are on me. I guess I'll have to trust and just believe what you say. Oh, you're coming again, coming to take me.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Bethel this morning. Would you please stand and join us as we open our worship service this morning?
You are before your God.
It really is a time to worship, but instead of doing scripture this morning, before we continue our worship, we're going to give you the opportunity to greet one another. Please do so at this time. Rise up, O men of God. Song is Standing on the Promises. Now, come come on, we can't sing standing on the promises sitting down. So will you stand and join us? Stand on the promises of God.
What a delight it is to gather for worship together this morning. Hopefully you received a worship folder on the way in. Lots of things coming up in the bulletin to take note of. Highlight just a couple of them this morning, a lot more than that. But number one, this Tuesday is a trip up to Clare, Michigan, seeing a number of different sites. The details are in the bulletin. But if you think, hey, that sounds like fun, well, make sure you read the bulletin, see about what's involved, and see Rick or Sharon Wood, let them know you'd like to come along. Then coming up on June 5th, we're going to have a missionary speaker with us that day, Leslie Geist, a young gal headed over to Ghent, Belgium. Most of us don't even have a clue where Belgium is, let alone know anything about the country, so we'll learn a lot about the country, and we'll learn about how God has laid his hand upon Leslie in her life and called her to Belgium. So that will be a great day for us. Then also on June 11th is a work day we're having here for the church. and say, oh, I can't work anymore. But we can all do something, whether it's washing windows, just spraying a little Windex and wiping windows down. Say, well, I can do that. So I'm sure there's something that each of us can do. June 11th, we'd love to have your help. Number of other things in the bulletin, take time to read through them. Reminder as well that we're not passing offering plates, but we have a box at the back where you can give back to honor the Lord. He has blessed us abundantly, and we give him all the praise. And so part of our act of worship is giving to honor the Lord. Let's pray to the Lord at this time. Father, it is so good to know that as we gather here for worship, you're present here with us. And it is our delight to praise your name. We thank you for all the help you've given us this past week and throughout the years. You are constant and faithful, and we know we can rely on you. You shower us daily with your blessings, and we say, great is your faithfulness, O God. We know that you have this world in your hands. So many times we look at all that's going on with shootings and war and political divide and all the contention that we face around us. And sometimes we feel hopeless, like how can anything good ever come? But we understand that this world is still in your control. And one day you are going to set everything right. And so we pray like John, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. But Lord, until you do come and establish your reign on the earth, Lord, we want to continue to faithfully look to you every day to be guided by your Spirit. And we pray that as we worship you today, that we would be changed to be more like you, because that is our desire, to be like Christ, that others will look at our life and be pointed to you. So we thank you for the chance to worship today. We thank you for the freedom in our nation and the leaders in our nation. And we pray today as we worship you that you would work on our hearts and change us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I know I've been making you get up and down a lot this morning, so if you don't feel like standing for this next one, you may remain seated, but I would appreciate it if anyone who could would stand and join us in singing Hosanna.
Washed.
Please be seated.
If you have your Bibles, I would invite you to turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We are continuing on in this letter that the Apostle Paul writes to Christians in the city of Corinth. The city of Corinth was sort of like the New York City of its day. It was a major trade city. Everybody going east or west went through the city of Corinth. Paul had started a church there. He spent about 2 years with them, teaching them the word of God, giving them all the truth they needed for their lives. And then he moves on to another location. But as Paul has moved on, he hears about problems in the church. And so he writes this letter of 1 Corinthians to address the problems in the church. The first issue that Paul addresses is the issue of unity. In chapter 1, we see the problem related. Paul was told that Christians were having a problem and following their favorites. And they had different cliques, different groups in the church. Some followed Paul, some followed Apollos, some followed Peter, and those who wanted to be really spiritual said, well, we just follow Christ. And so the church was divided. In chapter 2, we see Paul's reasoning. Paul points out the messenger is not important. The presentation isn't important. It's the message that's important. It's the gospel that's important. And we need to focus not on following the leaders. We need to focus in on the truth of the gospel. And the power of the gospel comes from the Holy Spirit. In the second half of chapter 2, Paul talks about the Holy Spirit at work. We come to chapter 3 and we see here the practical reality. The Christians at Corinth were not living in the power of the Spirit. Chapter 2, he's talked about the power of the Spirit, but chapter 3, we see they had a very worldly focus, a very fleshly focus. I love one of Chuck Swindoll's poems. It says, "To live above with saints we love, for me that will be glory. But to live below with saints we know, now that's another story." You know, we can say, oh yeah, we're Christians and we all just get along and love one another. But the practical reality is Christians still struggle. Christians have a lot of issues that need to be addressed. So there is a very real problem in the lives of these Corinthian believers. Come to chapter 3, starting in verse 1. Paul writes and says, "Brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you are not yet ready for it. Indeed, you're still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For when one says, 'I follow Paul,' and another, 'I follow Apollos,' are you not mere men? What, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose, and each will be rewarded according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building." Let's pray together. Father, we come today because we admit your word is truth. And here in this chapter, there is so much truth for us to grasp. But to truly understand what you're saying and how it applies to our lives, we need the help of your Holy Spirit. to turn the light on for us, to give us that understanding. Lord, we come to your word not just with a desire to know what it says, but we come with the desire to put into practice what we see, to be changed, to be more like you by living according to the truth of what your word teaches. So help us, Lord, each to come away with something we can work on, something we can change, some way to be more like you. Speak to us today, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We look at the problems that they were facing at Corinth, and it's easy to read the scriptures and just let this to be an academic lesson. Oh, okay, now I know what was happening at Corinth. Now I know what they were like. But instead, we want this to be a spiritual lesson. We want to learn what we are like and how we need to change based upon what we see in this passage. A reminder, first, Romans 15:4 tells us, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope." So my hope, my desire is that as we look at these verses together, we won't say, oh, that's what happened at Corinth. We'll say, oh, this is what I am like. This is what I need to learn. This is what I need to change. We come to the Word of God so that we can be changed. So the practical reality of the church at Corinth was that even though they had the Holy Spirit did not have them. They were Christians, but they were living in a very worldly way. We see here, first of all, Paul's examination. Paul looks at the situation. He points out there are two types of Christians: those who are spiritual, those who are worldly. So, first of all, those who are spiritual. But Paul's not referring to people who have a lot of knowledge. Having a lot of head knowledge does not make you spiritual. A spiritual Christian is one who is led by the Holy Spirit, who walks with the Spirit, who follows the leading of the Holy Spirit, whose life is under the control of the Holy Spirit. And I trust that is what you would say, I try constantly to live according to what the Holy Spirit shows me. But the second type is the Christian who has the Spirit but does not listen to the Spirit, but rather the person who follows the impulses of their flesh, their desires. The person who says, yeah, I know God wants me to do this, but I really want to do this. So a spiritual Christian and a worldly Christian, a carnal Christian, a fleshly Christian. So Paul is going to give a description now of what these carnal Christians are like. He says, worldly Christians are babies. He says, brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. Paul says, I am writing to a bunch of babies. They should have been mature. They should have been growing. They should have been making progress. They should have been working on these issues. Instead, they were allowing these divisions to tear them apart. They were living fleshly lives. The fact that they were arguing and were divided over these personalities shows that they were not spiritually mature. They were spiritually babies. And babies need milk. One of the big things you've been hearing in the news lately, anytime you turn on the news, is this national baby formula shortage. And parents are frantic because they know we can't get formula. Our babies need milk. But why don't all these parents just give their babies steak? There's plenty of steakhouses open. Why don't they just go through Burger King or McDonald's and buy them a couple Whoppers or quarter pounders with cheese and give them to the babies? See, that's foolish. Babies can't eat steak. Babies can't eat hamburgers. Babies need milk. And spiritual babies can't handle the deep truths of the Word of God. They need basic truths. Milk. Hebrews 12 describes it this way. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. So this is the same idea. The Corinthians have been Christians now for a couple of years. They should have been growing, they should have been maturing, they should have been following the Holy Spirit, but instead they are just living by their fleshly desires. And that caused jealousy, it caused arguments, it caused dissension, it caused these cliques that were taking place. They were still babies. They still cried out, well, feed me, feed me, feed me. And there are many churches where Christians do not grow because the pastor every Sunday preaches a salvation message. I attended a church like that years ago where every Sunday it was a salvation message. And I believe in sharing the gospel. I believe in people being saved. But just to give a salvation message every Sunday does not help people to grow spiritually. It's giving them milk every week where they need to grow on and go to meet truth of God's word. Everyone understands babies need milk. But when a child is 5, 10, 20, 50, you still don't drink that bottle of milk. Paul says, you need to grow up. You're spiritual babies, you're drinking milk, you need to grow up. He points something else out about babies. Babies are messy. And Paul is pointing out that their lives are a mess. Verse 3, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere men? Paul says, you're showing that you're a baby by all this quarreling, all this division that's taking place. You're still a baby, you're fighting over men. Think about how possessive toddlers are. You try to take their bottle away, try to take their pacifier away, and they are grabbing, they are screaming, mine, 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 and they are bawling until you give that pacifier back or that bottle back. They instantly grab for it, hold on to it tightly, and start crying. So this is Paul's examination of the Corinthians. They are babies who need to grow up. Even though they are Christians, they are fleshly Christians, worldly Christians, driven by their desire instead of following the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, the sad truth is that Christians all across the U.S., all across the world, are just like this. Spiritually immature, spiritual babies. And a good example of this is Ronnie. Let's meet Ronnie.
Ronnie.
Well, the pastor asked me to do it, so I said, sure.
Every once in a lifetime, we meet someone who literally changes us forever. Ronnie is not one of those people.
I may not be the most eloquent orator on this side of the lights and the camera, but I am not gonna say no to my new church. I have been a member of 10 churches in the last 8.5 years. See, here's what I do. I join these churches with hope. Hope that they'll provide me with what I need.
Ronnie's thoughts on worship.
Music draws me in. There is no question about it. Look, I may not play an instrument, but I know worship, and music equals worship, okay? God created me to spend at least a 15 to 17 minute block of music each week at church in worship. And that's in the Bible, folks. I can show you it anywhere in the Psalms.
Ronnie's thoughts on preaching.
Okay, then the worship finishes, and then the preacher stands up and preaches. Now, God and I both require that the preacher makes me laugh and makes me cry. The sermon must have a story every 4 to 5 minutes, or else I just get lost in all that history of the Jews stuff. The preacher, I like to say, feeds me.
Ronnie's thoughts on spiritual growth.
When you think about it, I guess that's why I love modern Christianity so much. It's just so easy to be a part of it, but to always reserve the right to just leave the church when they don't meet my expectations. I mean, okay, maybe God's asking me to take responsibility for my own spiritual growth. No, he isn't. That's silly. I mean, that's what the pastor gets paid to do. He gets paid to learn and to grow and to pursue God, so I don't have to. Yeah.
We see a Ronnie, and we think, oh, who could ever be like that? The sad truth is, we know many Ronnies. We know many people who find excuse after excuse after excuse for why they're not growing, why they're not living like they should, why they're not faithful in worship, because it's all about me. Give me what I want. Meet my needs. Me, me, me. Just like that baby. Me, me, me. Spiritual babies. So Paul is saying that there are a lot of Ronnies in the congregation at Corinth. Paul has given the examination. He has said, you're babies, you need to grow up. Now he's going to give the explanation. Look in verse 5. What after all is Apollos? What is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose. Each will be rewarded according to his own labor, for we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. The reason we don't argue about leaders in the church is because the leaders are not important. They're simply servants. They are busboys. You go out to a fancy restaurant, you don't say, oh, my busboy was so good, he cleaned the table so well. No, that's his job. He's just simply doing his job. Paul says the leaders are simply servants, just like all of us are serving God. We all have gifts to use for God's glory, and we simply want to use our gifts. I used to work for a company that did industrial insulation, and often we would work in industrial plants. I was telling a couple of the men about this morning. I worked for the insulation company, but I was in the M&M Mars candy factory. And whenever the factory would start up a new line, there were all types of workers involved. There would be electricians running all the electrical lines. There would be pipe fitters putting up all the new piping. We insulators would cover the pipes so the chocolate would stay nice and warm. Carpenters were putting up all the walls. Plasterers were covering the walls. Everyone had a job to do. It's the same way in the church. The fleshly, worldly spirit causes us to be envious, to be jealous of one another. But the Christian following the Holy Spirit understands that we all work together. Each one of us has a job to do. We will each have different gifts to use, but there should be no competition in the body of Christ. As we go on in 1 Corinthians, we'll see that the Christians in Corinth were arguing over who had the best job, who had the greatest gifts. And they are arguing, well, yeah, you're gifted that, but I have this gift, and that's so much better than your gift. But Paul's premise is that every gift is not given for our own glory. God gives us gifts to use for the common good, for the whole body of Christ. So we have nothing to boast about. We have nothing to brag about. Rather, we're all working together. And then Paul gives a couple of illustrations. He says, the church is a field. Verse 9, Paul states, for we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field. If you're going to plant a garden, there are several steps to take. In the spring, you go out and you rototill the ground up. You get everything soil loosened. You may plow some rows to plant the seed in rows. Then you plant the seed. But then you have to water. If we have a spell where it doesn't rain for a while, you need to make sure you get out there and water the plants. As the plants grow, you need to pull the weeds or hoe the weeds down. And then when the crop is ready, somebody needs to harvest the crop, bring the crop in. And different people may accomplish each task. That's what Paul says happened in Corinth. He says in verse 6, I planted the seed. Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. Paul says, I've got nothing to boast about. I just planted the seed. Don't boast about Apollos. He just watered the seed. If you want to boast about anything, boast about God. He's the one who caused the church to grow. Then Paul gives a different picture. We're God's field. And he says the church is a building as well. In a garden, there are different tasks to be done in the same way when you're building a structure. There are different jobs to be done. And each job is important. Paul says we all have the same foundation, verse 11. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. So in the church, we all agree on the foundational truth that we are saved by grace through faith in what Christ has done for us. That's the foundation of the church. But as a structure, how will we grow? We need to be careful how we build. I mentioned working in the M&M Mars plant. Sometimes pipe fitters would come through and they'd get all their pipes run and everything looked perfect. And then they'd turn on the water. And the water would just start spewing out all over all these joints. And they'd say, we have a problem. It wasn't done right. We need to go back and fix all those joints. Paul says, I laid the foundation. As a contractor, I got the church off, started right. But now you need to be careful how you build. And so that leads us to Paul's evaluation. There are two classes of builders, two ways of building. He uses the idea of materials that you use to build with. There's wood, hay, and stubble builders, and there are gold, silver, and precious stone builders. Two types of material. One is permanent, gold, silver, costly stones. The characteristic of these is that they withstand the fire. Gold, silver, and costly stones are permanent. They'll never fail. The other three are exactly the opposite. Highly combustible material, wood, hay, and straw. They're temporary. You can build a house out of wood, and it might look impressive, but if it catches fire, it's not going to be staying there very long. Wind can blow it down. Fire can burn it. Think back to one of our favorite children's stories, The Three Pigs. Three little pigs, one builds a house out of straw, one out of sticks, and one out of stone. And then along comes the big bad wolf. And only the third piggy, who built his house out of stone, was able to survive the huffing and the puffing of the big bad wolf. Paul says, each of us is building on the foundation of Christ. But we need to be careful how we build, what we're building with, because we'll all face an evaluation. Here he says in verse 12, if any man builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. So he's saying there will be a time of revelation where God shines his spotlight and evaluates what our works are like. As God looks at what we've done with our lives, he brings things to light. And as we look at the scriptures, we understand that one of the things we will be judged on is our attitude. God cares not only about what we do, but about why we do it. One of the passages I think that expresses this so clearly is Matthew 6, where Jesus is pointing out the Pharisees, the religious leaders of the Jews. And God warns us there against doing good things with wrong attitudes. He says, the Pharisees, they sound trumpets. Anytime they're going to give to the poor, they blow the trumpet so everybody can see that they're giving money to the poor. He says, when they pray, they stand out on the street corner so everybody can hear them praying, that they are praying to God. Jesus says in Matthew 6, I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. So when we do things, even good things, with the wrong attitude, with the wrong motivation, God says, you don't get rewards for that. You've already got your reward. You got the praise of men. That's all the reward you're going to get. So God looks at our works and he says, we need to make sure we have the right attitude. Do the right thing, but make sure we know why we're doing it, doing it with the right motivation. Secondly, God will reveal our acceptability. God cares that about doing things the right way. 2 Timothy 2:5. Similarly, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not receive the victor's crown unless he competes according to the rules. So it's not always the first one across the finish line who wins the race. You need to follow the rules. Paul says later on in 1 Corinthians 9, he doesn't want to be disqualified for the prize. So let's say you're having a race. Let's say you're doing a marathon and somebody got picked up by a taxi halfway along and dropped them off near the finish line. They might be the first one across the line, but they're going to say, I'm sorry, you're disqualified. You didn't run this all yourself. So we want to make sure that we do right things with the right attitude, but do them in the right way as well. So that many times Christians are foolish in how we try to do right. Don't go out and bomb a Planned Parenthood building. Don't go out with an assault rifle when there's a protest march going on. So many times Christians get a bad reputation because foolish Christians go out and they might say, well, I want to do right, but they don't do it in the right way. Let's make sure we have the right motivation. Let's make sure we're doing things in the right way. Then thirdly, we're evaluated based on ability. And one of the wonderful things about the Christian life is we never need to be anyone else. We simply need to be the best me that I can be. Somebody said, be yourself. Everyone else is already taken. Far too often, we look at others and say, oh, if only I had their giftedness, oh, what I'd do. God doesn't evaluate us on how we compare to others. He evaluates us simply on what we've done with what he's given us. The question is, will we use what we have been given? We don't have the same evaluation that somebody else has, say, oh, I could never be a Billy Graham. God doesn't want us to be a Billy Graham. God wants us to use what he has given us. An evangelist was once raising money for an orphanage and asked the man and said, would you, if you had $1 million, would you give $1 million for the orphanage? The man said, oh, I certainly would. Then he said, well, would you give God $20? And he said, preacher, that's just not fair. You know I have $20. Far too often, we say, oh, I can't do everything. But the question is, what can we do? What has God given us that we can use for his glory? So will we use our ability for the Lord? One day God will reveal our attitudes, our acceptability, our abilities. And so it will be a time of revelation where God brings to light what we have done. It will also be a time of reward. Look in verse 14. Let's go to 13. His work will be shown for what it is because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. 14. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. So we understand that we are not saved by works. We're saved by grace, by faith in what Jesus Christ has done for us. We're not saved by our works, but we are rewarded for our works. Salvation is all of Christ, but the rewards that we receive are for our works. Revelation 22:12, Jesus says, behold, I'm coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to everyone according to what he has done. So works won't get us to heaven, but works follow us to heaven. We are rewarded on the basis of how we have used the gifts that God has given us. But the coming day, it will be a day of reward, but it will also be a day of regret, a time of regret. Verse 15, if it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. When we don't build the right way, when we're not doing the right thing, we don't lose our salvation, but we will lose our rewards. The picture is someone who is in their house, and the house catches fire, and they somehow manage to get through the flames and get out of the house, but the house burns down, they lose everything they have, but they've escaped the burning house. You may be saved, but you've lost everything that's precious. One day we will stand before God. And for those who did not work for God, for those who didn't build the right way, for those who were carnal, who were worldly, who did not follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, it will be a time of regret. So Paul has given an examination of the situation. He's given an explanation. Don't follow us. We're just servants of God. He's given an evaluation. We're going to be rewarded for how we build, and we're going to regret it if we don't live rightly. Now he gives an exhortation. In light of all that he's taught them here in this chapter, what should we do? How should this truth affect our lives? First of all, don't attack other Christians. Verse 17. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is sacred, and you are that temple. So we understand that as Christians, the Holy Spirit of God is within us. We are his temple. Don't attack other Christians. far too many times we allow ourselves to be led by that fleshly pride that makes us think we're better than others. And so we attack those who do not hold to the same things we do, those who don't live the same way we do. Paul says, don't attack other Christians. You attack God's temple, God's going to destroy you. Don't attack other Christians. Secondly, realize that boasting about mere men is foolish. It's the wisdom of this world. Verse 20, the Lord knows that the thoughts of the wise are futile. So then, no more boasting about men. So don't be bragging about men. That's just foolishness. That's the world's way of thinking. If you're going to boast about something, boast about God. So keep your focus on God. There's the third lesson we come away with. Keep your focus on God. Verse 21, all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, another name for Peter, or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours, and you are of Christ, and Christ is of God. The more we focus on building the kingdom of God together, working together as brothers and sisters in Christ, the less fighting there'll be, the less arguments there will be, the less cliques there'll be. God's desire, once again, is this idea of unity. We all work together. We're all on the same team. And each of us uses whatever gifts we have. We don't have to envy one another. We don't have to figure out a pecking order of who's more spiritual than one another. When we do that, that's being carnal. That's being worldly. That's pride entering in. Rather, we all get along together. In the words of the old hymn, Onward Christian Soldiers, the second verse, like a mighty army moves the church of God. Brothers, we are treading where the saints have trod. We are not divided, all one body we, one in hope and doctrine, one in charity. May God help us all to live together in unity. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you have reminded us that we are nothing special. We're just servants that you've chosen to use. You've given us each a range of gifts to use for your glory, and we never want to boast about those gifts because they came from you. We don't need to compare ourselves to one another. We don't need to try to be like anybody else. We simply need to follow the leading of your Spirit. And when we do that, when we cooperate and work together, we'll all get along and you receive the glory. Help us, Lord, not to attack others, not to criticize others, not to put others down. But may we lift one another up, may we bear one another's burdens, and may we so fulfill the law of Christ. Help us, Lord, to live together in unity. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Will you please stand and join us as we conclude our service this morning?
The
what I pray. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Hopefully that is not just a song you sing. Hopefully that is the prayer of your heart, that God changes our heart to be more like Him. Thank you for coming. You are dismissed.